local organizations. One of those is KW Counseling, which provides counseling and many other services for persons who otherwise would not be able to afford them. This morning, as we celebrate our Might Can ministry, we recognize that one of the sources from which we provide for local agencies is your Might Cans. So I hope that you will be generous with them as this year closes and a new year begins. It is now a great privilege to welcome to St. Andrews Diane McGregor. Diane is the Director of Family and Community Solutions at KW Counseling, and we are eager to hear a message of their great work. Welcome to you, Diane.
Thank you all for including me in your sermon today. It's really my pleasure and honor to be here. So, as the Reverend said, my name is Diane McGregor, and I'm the Director of Family and Community Solutions at KW Counseling Services. That's a really big fancy title, for meaning that my work is primarily around in the area of public education, I suppose. And so I attend a variety of functions such as this. But the heart of what I do at my work is that I'm in charge of all of our parenting education. And as I look around the room, I imagine that many of you in the room are parents or perhaps are past your parenting years, but still remain parents in your hearts. So parenting is one of the major services that we provide at KW Counseling. At KW Counseling Services, we believe that change is always possible when relationships are enhanced. That is at the core of all of the work that we do. Our vision is for a community where no one is left behind, and a community that values positive relationships as its biggest achievement. And when you think about that, you can think about the power of that kind of message. And enhancing relationships, helping people to connect in their lives, to reconnect with people that have been in their lives in the past, and to form new relationships, whether it's within families, within communities, within churches, wherever the connection occurs, our work is driven towards improving relationships. We do this in a very wide number of ways, and if you let me stay up here for 3 days, I could probably tell you everything that we do, but I'm not going to stay here that long. We are, the core of our organization, of course, is counseling, and it is into our counseling program that your generous donation comes to us, particularly through our walk-in counseling clinic. I'm not sure if many of you have heard of our walk-in clinic, but it occurs on Thursdays, every Thursday from 12 until 6. And anyone and everyone is welcome at our walk-in counseling clinic. Now, there is a fee for our coming into our walk-in clinic. However, through donations such as the one that you bring to us, we are able to provide this service to people who cannot afford to pay for the counseling. We recently attended a conference in Banff, Alberta. Well, I didn't go. But our executive director and our manager of the walk-in clinic attended. And it was an international conference on walk-in clinics, or what's also called single session counseling. We learned that here at KW Counseling, we have one of the largest and most successful walk-in clinics in all of North America. While others were talking about managing, and having to coordinate numbers in the 20s and 30s, we often get between 70 and 80 people at our walk-in counseling clinic on a single Thursday, and those numbers stay high every single week. It is a service that is definitely needed within our community and is very valued by our community. We also provide, of course, therapeutic counseling, which is, as you well imagine, and that's for more than a single session. Again, many, many people access our services who could not afford to do this kind of counseling any other way than through our organization. because of the generous donations we receive from our donors, as well as the funding we receive from various foundations and organizations. Counseling isn't all that we do, though. We are very invested in the multicultural community, and we offer a very successful leadership program where we invite new Canadians and members from the multicultural community to come and learn about and learn about the skills that they need to help enhance and provide services within their own communities. We call it multicultural leadership, and people are trained not only in how to organize groups and create communities, they're also trained in how to access funding, how to write proposals, how to find where funding grants may be available, and create a way for their communities to come together and to connect with other communities in our larger community. We are very invested in the LGBTQ community within our organization. So we have a number of services that offer supports to, particularly to young people who are struggling or going through questioning about their own sexual orientation or their sexual identity. We offer services to the seniors community in our larger community. A couple of years ago, we realized that we weren't really able to respond to seniors in a meaningful way. We found that we didn't really have a lot of seniors coming to our organization, and we were really curious about that because we know, and as I look around the room, I know this too, that there are many of us here in this community. So we received a grant from the Ontario Trillium Foundation, and we launched on a large project, a research project essentially, to investigate what it is that seniors require in terms of support and counseling. And we went into the community and talked to many different seniors groups. And from that research, we're able to change the way that we're approaching our work with seniors. So we now believe that our capacity to provide meaningful, helpful, and accessible services for seniors has improved tremendously. I'm losing my list in my head about the number of services that we offer. We are very interested in the violence against women services in our province, and particularly in our region, and we provide services at no cost to women and children who have experienced violence in some capacity. One of the groups that we operate is called Strong Moms Safe Kids, and through that group we offer moms and their children a group experience in understanding about domestic violence and overcoming the trauma and the distress around that. We have one of those groups on right now, and they're very successful and very positive groups. We also operate several other group-related programs. One is a trauma-based organization for members of the Spanish community, or members who have come through, people who have come from South American countries. And I say this because it's offered in Spanish. So it's for the Spanish-speaking community who have come to our country through trauma, through experiencing trauma in their own countries. Finally, two of the groups that are very close to my heart are we work in the schools, in the Waterloo Region District School Board, and we provide a little program that we call STEAM. And it's an emotion regulation program that helps kids develop the skills that they need to manage their emotions more effectively and to create more positive relationships for themselves within their own communities. We have a clinic version of that that historically we had called temper taming. And now, but recently, in the last couple of years, thanks to a grant from the Bell Let's Talk Community Foundation, we've been able to expand that program to include parents in the group process with the children. So now we have parents coming in at the same time, and we provide parents with some information and the skills that they need to help their children manage their emotions and their social relationships more positively. And the children are learning these skills at once, and then they're sort of learning these things separately, and then we bring them together for these really amazing and fun activities. That leads me back to my parenting education, which is at the heart of what I do. And I say parenting education, but really what we have going is parenting Well, we call our program Parenting with Passion, and I believe that's because we call it that because we have such passion for helping parents raise the citizens of tomorrow. And if I could just, I just want to wrap up for a moment and share a story with you about the power of some of our parenting education. We don't teach timeouts and punishment and ways to get your child to obey. You might be sitting back there going, huh, well, what do you teach? What we teach about is how to connect and how to use our relationship, our emotional connections with our children to help support and guide them through their lives. And one of the concepts that we really focus on is something that comes up in the attachment literature. So parent-child attachment is something that's becoming very much a widely researched activity or a researched concept. And we teach this concept of the parent-child relationship as the safe haven for children and the safe haven for ourselves. So it's when those relationships are safe, warm, and loving and welcoming that we develop our sense of belonging and our capacity to manage our own emotions in effective ways. And one time in a course that I was facilitating, there was a man who was in the course, and he has two children. And him and his wife were going through a fairly difficult divorce and separation, and so he only had his children half of the time. And he was struggling with a lot of his own emotional challenges, as was the children's mother on the other side. And so, of course, you can imagine what the children were going through. And he was learning a lot from being in our courses, and he said to me that this notion of a safe haven was something that was really impacting him. And he told me a story that he had been trying to get his children ready for school one morning, and they were dragging their heels, right? As kids do. They were fussing, they weren't getting ready, and his son in particular was whining and crying, like not getting his coat on, and just dragging his heels. And the man was, and I'm sure many of you in this room can imagine what he was feeling. He needed to get to work, he didn't want to be late, he was feeling annoyed and frustrated. He also was dealing with a lot of stresses in his life, and he wasn't handling it well. So he was angry at his son, and he ended up making his son put his jacket on and then sort of hustling him out, sort of getting him in the car and wrapping him in his car seat and just being really what he felt to himself. He felt he was being mean to his son. And he said as he was driving along, he was thinking, this is not a safe haven for my son. I am not his safe haven. He is not feeling safe with me. And he was just pondering that. He gets the kids to school, and he walks his children to the door, and he said there was something in his heart that just made him stop at the door and wait. And he stood outside the door, and he watched his son walk down the corridor towards his classroom. And he said, he watched his son, and his son stopped at the door of his classroom and looked back at the window and saw his dad was still there. Sorry, I can never get through this story without choking up. And he saw that his dad was still there, and his son turned and ran back down the hall to his dad. And so he hugged him, and his son hugged him and clung really closely to him, and his dad said, oh, buddy, that's the best thing that's happened to me today. That's an amazing hug. And the boy said, I love you, Dad. The boy and turned and walked cheerfully into his classroom. He knew that in that moment, the dad had created that safe haven for his son. And his son was then able to face the day and to face all of the things that he's dealing with, knowing the safety and love that he had in his relationship with his dad. I'm going to be downstairs in the coffee area, and I welcome any of you to come up and speak to me downstairs. I have copies of our resources there, and you're welcome to take any of them. And I would love to talk with you and answer any questions that you might have. Thank you so much for inviting me here today.
Thank you.
sharing with us a little bit about the work of KW Counseling. It is our great privilege to be a small part of it. Let us pray. Holy God, let your healing word come to these people now through me, or if the need be, then in spite of me, for Christ's sake. Amen. In Jeremiah 33, the world was falling apart. It was 587 BC, and Nebuchadnezzar had destroyed the temple in Jerusalem, and the people were broken. In Luke 21, from verse 25 onward, the people were devastated because now Rome had ransacked Jerusalem, destroyed the temple again, and the people were broken and frightened, and everything was falling apart. And in each of those cases, when the world was falling apart and everything was going wrong, God said to his people, "Do not fear, I am with you. Your Savior is coming, and you will be rescued and restored, and there will be peace and justice." Luke says to those broken people, "Stand up, raise your hand. Your salvation is close to you." And for all of you, I say, when the time of trouble comes for you, trust the Lord, trust that you have a safe haven, and do not be afraid. This is the season of Advent when all of us rest in our safe haven. For his name's sake,